In our tradition, the time of rest begins with the lighting of a candle. In this moment, the stopping truly begins. To take a few breaths, to allow the mind to quieten, this is the beginning of sacred time. We light this candle to kindle a flame of warmth as a reminder of the connection that draws us into a community that opens us up in gratitude for the gifts of this day alive. There is mystery at the heart of things, and it is alive and sings its song into all that is moribund and plain. It is born of a wonder that only increases, for in exploring the wonder grows. In understanding, a greater puzzle is revealed. The more we dive into the riddle, we find a yet greater enigma. Let us bring all our traditions, paths of experience, generations of questions, and rich tapestry of faith. And together, weaving a gathering here with the ever-evolving, always transfiguring, forever renewing, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. The reading is from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, verses 31 to 40. Jesus said, "Haven't you read what God told you? I am the God of Abraham and Sarah, the God of Isaac and Rebekah, the God of Jacob and Rachel and Leah. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living." When the crowds heard this, they were astonished at Jesus' teaching. And when the Pharisees heard that Jesus had left the Sadducees speechless, they gathered together. And one of them, an expert on the law, attempted to trick Jesus with this question: "Teacher, which commandment of the law is the greatest?" Jesus answered, "You must love the Most High God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. That is the greatest and first commandment. The second is like it. You must love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments, the whole law is based, and the prophets as well."
This is the second in our 2023 series, What Makes a Christian? It's amazing how often we fail a most basic mark of the faith. It's a downright scandal how rarely it is preached. It's questionable how directly our religious and moral practices stem from it. Yet, if we believe the direct words of Jesus himself in the Gospels, the very ability of others to recognise our Christian identity is dependent on how we follow this. All across the world, and for many centuries, we gather in churches. We have elaborate worship and praise. And yet, we barely give lip service to the first and foremost of the commandments. And when we do it, it is often to give exceptions. No, Jesus didn't really mean that. I am, of course, talking about the greatest commandment as it's known. Love God and love neighbour.
abundantly. Christians seem to often spend more time talking about, for example, obscure lines from the Bible or obscure doctrines about obscure topics. And it's amazing how very little time we actually spend on the fundamental core command that Jesus himself preached to us. Jesus is very clear that the fundamental commandment is to love God and neighbour, and that our public witness of this will be the very mark of our Christian identity. That's it. All else gets, at best, a distant second or third place. And yet, our denial knows no bounds. It is so simple, yet so difficult. We do everything we can to make being Christian about something else. It's about church membership, a certain baptismal formula, or having the right beliefs. Even denominations at odds with one another have this in common. Now, you could argue that these other things are important too, but we put them front and centre when Jesus was quite clear that something else was front and centre. He actually comes out and tells us to put this commandment first, and we seem to do everything except that. Now, of course, we don't deny the greatest commandment. Oh no, we would never be so bold. Rather, we do something far more sinister. We just sort of brush it aside, put it on a pedestal, and otherwise ignore it. We box it in, we limit it, we put the ropes around it because, in truth, it scares the living daylights out of us. And so, we find ways to rationalise. We find every excuse not to love abundantly, not to overflow with mercy, not to do all that love requires of us. And for example, we can find it in all sorts of examples in scripture and church history to support all sorts of actions. Oh, the Bible is full of war and violence of all kinds, so we could claim biblical support for these actions. Before we blindly imitate them and claim some scriptural authority and scriptural backing, we should ask, does this, whatever it might be, love God and love neighbourly abundantly? And if not, it should go straight to the fires of Gehenna. Still, individuals and churches do everything they can to wiggle out of these requirements and try to make it out to be about something else. It's not that those other things haven't their place. The scandal is the disproportionate amount of energy we put into those obscure things compared to what should be first and foremost. And let's be clear, it's absolutely and totally a scandal how we treat the greatest commandment. We give lip service to love. We attempt it here and there. We're a wee bit like unruly teenagers whose parents have told us to clean the house when they're gone. So we spend the first hours watching TV, lying about, talking to our friends, and yes, in the back of our heads, thinking about cleaning the house from time to time. And true to form, about 10 minutes before the parents return, we run roughshod over the house to give the appearance of cleanliness. That's how we regard the commandment to love. Yes, we do talk about it. Just enough to get that monkey off our back and claim that we are following it. But the level of enthusiasm and energy that we put into it is not anywhere near what we are commanded to do by Jesus. Just look at the General Synod of the Church of England and blessing same-sex marriages to give a very current example. Jesus' message is both incredibly simple and also incredibly difficult at the same time. Little children get it. The poor get it. Those on the margins of society, they get it. But the more and more stuff we have just makes it more difficult to hear the message. And it doesn't matter if the stuff is material wealth or just something else that we are holding on to. It could be anger. It could be our ego. It could be our need to be right all the time. The Gospels predict this. The more attached people were to their stuff, whatever it might be, the harder time they had accepting the truth of Jesus and following. Let that stuff go, and you start to see Jesus. Maybe the message of Jesus is like looking into the sun. It's just so bright that we can't do it for long. All we can do is hint and squint at it and try and come back to it later when we're ready. And there's a case to be made for that. Maybe, after all, humankind will always be sun worshippers, the first and perhaps the only religion. But our act of participation in love puts us in line with love. Love, the creative energy of the universe. And love, it is, which is the wavelength of eternity.
We light this candle in remembrance and hope to call to mind Magnus and Ronald and all the saints and all those dear to us who have gone before, especially those who have died in recent times. And as a sign of hope to future generations as yet unborn, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life."
Thank you.
a prayer. We pray for the needs of all those across this small planet who are in great need this day, and especially for the people of southern Turkey and northern Syria. We are mindful of all those who suffer because of the winter weather, of all who suffer because they experience the winter of war, of all those who suffer the cold winds of oppression and violence. May all who suffer this day experience compassion through their brothers and sisters. May this morning prayer awaken us to turn to the needs of all who ask us for help this day, into our personal needs. May this brief time of prayer make us aware that the needs of those whom we assist are really Christ's needs. May we have the grace to see him in all whom we meet and serve. With that sacred vision, this prayer of communion with his Spirit will have no end. Blessed and beautiful is our journey with Christ. May his light be our sun this winter day. Amen.
Thuma, mina.
Thuma, mina.
Living, we are living in the love of God. We are moved.
May the God you see in all the colours of creation arouse in you a sense of awe and wonder. May the God who is a sacred presence be real to you. May the God who is a source of inspiration and courage keep calling you forward. May you stay safe in the way of Christ, and may you be blessed by his Spirit this day and always. Amen.